Yes. So these servlet programs, basically which reside on the server, will try to create the dynamic web contents. The process of this dynamic web content creation basically involves, most of the time, the user request may not be immediately available on the server. That can the server can service the requests that are being given to the server by the different users or from the different resources. So servlets will help us or enable us to prepare the outputs or the responses to be given to various requests coming from different sources or coming from different elements or different entities. So basically, this servlet programming involves the concept of request response. So a request coming from the client to the server. So basically, those requests will be of what methods or of what protocols? Can you please give me the answer? The request will be coming from different clients in the form of. Any answers, please? In the form of HTTP request, in the form of HTTP methods, those HTTP methods. So what are the various HTTP methods?
Get and post.
Yes, your get, your post, your delete, HTTP. These are the various HTTP. HTTP is of what type of, whether it is a RESTful or is a REST protocol? What is the REST representational state transfer protocol? So the representations that are coming from various clients, those representations, those requests are going to be served by the server. So the request usually come in the form of your get, post, delete, or whatever it may be, the different methods that are being governed by the HTTP protocol. So if at all your request that are coming from different client means as a user request which is coming through the browser of a particular machine from a client side to the server side, if that request is not available, in the sense that the request cannot be served by the server, served means cannot be giving, is unable to give some outputs to the request that is made by the client, then the servlet programs will try to prepare the logic or will prepare those requests with the help of a container. A container is nothing but basically a server which is residing on that particular computer. So that container, that server will try to prepare your logic, the business logic or the requests that are coming there, and accordingly the responses will be given to the client. So earlier to servlets, in the, of course, in the olden days, we have another similar technology. What is the technology name called as before to the servlets? The technology is called as CGI. What does CGI stands for?
Common Gateway.
Yes, Common Gateway Interface, CGI. CGI technology was there before the servlets technology. I have given this in my presentation slides last time. I think you might have not gone through or you did not find time. So Common Gateway Interface is also one type of request response model. But the basic difference between CGI and servlets, of course, servlets are the new technologies as compared to CGI. Obviously, it will have its own advantage. So tell me, what are those advantages and what problem is going to be overcome by these servlets as compared to the CGI? Yes, please. What is the advantage of having servlets? Many concurrent requests can be served. Many concurrent requests. It means if your server is getting many requests at the same time, Of course, there is a limit for that. It is not that infinite. So the server has its own limitations. The server means basically, what does the server? Server will have its computational resources. So what are the different computational resources? Of course, your CPU, your memory, your communication capabilities, computation bandwidth, and all this comes into picture. So server is basically trying to serve many requests which are coming from various computers across the network. So those requests, if many parallel requests, in other terms, concurrent requests are coming, will the CGI will be able to serve many requests at the same time? I have given an hint for you to give the answer. Yes, please. What happens is a CGI, whenever you are using the CGI technology, the CGI technology at the server side, what happens is each request is nothing but a process. Each request which is coming to the server is a process, and that process creates, or the process consumes, a lot of computational resources. Even the CPU, the memory space that is available on the server, the CPU processing computational power that is also going to be used a lot, the memory space, each process. If there are many processes, then obviously your memory space is going to be consumed if you are using the CGI technology, and only with very few requests can be served concurrently. So that is the drawback of the CGI technology. Whereas the servlets, because the servlets use the thread concepts, the thread technology, the threads is basically a lightweight process. The threads will take less amount of memory, and as well as because that common space or the common computational area need not be given for each and every process, because the thread itself will take what are the other requirements based on the computational aspects. So thread is going to be more advantageous here, which is a lightweight process, and the CPU and the memory can be consumed very less as compared to the CGI. Have you gone through those slides or not? Yes, please.
Yes, sir.
Then why you are not giving the answers? You are very much tired after the test is over. So the slides is basically, I hope I kept the slides on this material on the course page. Yeah, introduction to servlets. Yes, see, please go through this material which I already posted on the. See here, this is the basic concept. So here, servlet request, you can see it on the diagram. Is my screen visible to you?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Yeah, so you can see there are multiple threads. So each request is given to as a thread. It is not a separate process. If it is given as a separate process, then each process will take each memory area. Memory means each memory addresses, the space of the server. The space of the server, in other terms, the memory of the server is going to be consumed if you are taking each request as a process. So whereas a servlet takes each request as a thread. So you can run multiple threads on the same container, that is the web container, basically on the web server, on the server which is you are running here. So it takes only less processor load. That's what you can see in this diagram as compared to the other technology which I'm mentioning here. This is the other technology. So you can see that each request is made a separate process, and that separate process is going to consume more memory here, and obviously the more CPU consumption is also going to be there. So CGI has got having a big drawback, which cannot serve more concurrent requests, whereas the servlets can serve that particular purpose. So this is one of the main difference of CGI and servlets. Of course, the advantage of servlet too. And can you tell me what is the other advantage of the servlet as compared to CGI? At least look to the space. Please go through this material. Tell me any other one more advantage here of servlets or CGI. Yes, please. S- So servlets are basically your Java programs which are running on the server side. Very simple answer. So as compared to CGI, the number of requests can be more. Servlets is going to serve that more number of requests as compared to your CGI. So you can see that you can see the advantages of servlets. Already a general advantages have given to you here. So the servlets basically has got the phenomenon of something called as request response. So that point, that particular point, you need to also specify and you need to understand what is this request response. So each request and response comes through your HTTP requests only. So those HTTP requests and those HTTP methods will enable you to, so the requests which are coming from the client to the server, all these are basically your HTTP request, and the server which is running on the other side may have connection to your database also. That is basically, and on the server you have a container. That container will prepare the programs, the logic which suppose the existing server does not hold, what to be done if a request comes here. The automatically the server also look into its aspect of how to respond to the different requests that may come from the different clients. So that auto preparation of that logic, that is the advantage of the servlets. They can prepare their own logic on that. So again, there are many interfaces and classes in the servlet API. Something called servlet itself is one class, super class. Generic servlet is another super class. HTTP servlet is another base class. Similarly, a servlet request and servlet response. So these parameters, servlet request, servlet response, are the parameters which you can make use of them for preparing your servlets and interacting with the servlets, and for your dynamic web contents preparation very easily. So this is some of the basics that you need to go through. So let us write some program and understand for today's session. And next week we'll go through the JSP along with the servlets and other MySQL databases for the next 2 weeks. So here I already installed. So in order to practice servlets and the JSPs, I told you that we need to install an Apache Tomcat server. So this is an open source Apache Tomcat server. You can see here basically. So that server is already installed, Apache Tomcat server on my machine. Locally it has been installed. Of course the version is 9. You can get it 10 and other versions if you like to have it from the their website. So once you are configured, installation, in other terms, that once you have connected your Tomcat server with your Eclipse IDE, I'm going forward from that point, because I don't want to waste time in showing you all the steps. It will itself will take another 1 hour, 1.5 hour to complete the installation process if your CPU is very less capable enough. So anyway, I'm just assuming that you also know how to install it. You can Google it, or you can see the YouTube, or you can get it, the installation process. Let us not waste time, and you can directly practice on the programs. So okay, let me just start. So this is an Eclipse IDE Enterprise Edition of this Eclipse. So it supports various servers to run on this Enterprise Edition. So here I am selecting the project type. So here basically when you click the new, from the file menu option, the new sub menu option, you will see there is something called as dynamic web projects. So this basically dynamic web projects is a project which you are going to just for practice purpose you start writing from here. Later you can write your own servlets and you can integrate them, but for a beginner you can start from this dynamic web projects. That will be always a good practice for you to understand the intricacies. The intricacies means the internal details about the servlet programming. You can start from this particular point, dynamic web projects. So once you click the dynamic web projects, obviously you will get the step by step process. So it will help you to prepare its own framework structure. So it will ask for me the project name. I am giving some name, something like my first application or some servlet application, whatever you can call it as. We can So my first servlet application, you can keep, please make sure that you are already Tomcat, Apache Tomcat server is running on your machine. So it will always select the same the target runtime server for your application to run on that server. So you are preparing an application now. You are writing a program to run it on the server and make sure the server is available on this. So if it is installed and configured correctly, you'll see this target runtime Apache Tomcat like this. So once you are given the name of your project, my first servlet application, click next. So you can keep the default values. Just it will select the Java file path as well as the folders, the class files. Once the Java file is compiled, you will get the .class file. So those .class files are going to be stored in a folder here. If you want, you can customize all those things. And so your content directory is a directory which can hold all the files together which are related to your project. So you just see that and make sure that you are enabling generate the web.xml deployment descriptor. This is a deployment, means you are going to deploy it onto your server. So your server is going to understand this .xml file. So what does .xml file contains? Anyone please, can you, anyone answer? What does the .xml file contain? Hello. Am I audible to you, please? I can see you.
We can define our own
tags. Sorry, Raghavendra, I could not hear your voice clearly. Can you please repeat?
In XML, we can define our own tags.
Okay, XML. What does an XML mean? You can define your own tags. Okay, you can customize your tags. User-defined tags can be there. That's what you are telling. Okay, of course, here we are going to prepare. Our application is going to, once the servlet has been created, you will have, of course, the .xml file. It is an extended markup language file. Of course, the user-defined tags, where it will be linking those, your class file and your output files. So to those files can easily run on your web browser or onto the web. So as a request which is coming from the client side, those responses will be stored so that those values can be easily seen on this. So we just enable this generate web.xml deployment descriptor and just click the finish. So it is now preparing a project structure for us. That project structure will involve, it consist of your Java files, your XML files, your your HTML files, which are all related to your web application contents, and your library files, which are going to interact with those particular files. So just it will take a couple of minutes to prepare. Once it is done, so you can see it on the left side in the Project Explorer window. You can see here in this Project Explorer window, you can see various Java web services. And you can see the Java files, you can see the SRC source files. So under the main, you can have two different types of folders. One is your Java file folder and another is basically related to your web applications. So basically the manifestations of the web page and as well as the link and the library files which are related to your web page are all going to be here. So this is basically an organization of your servlet application, which will keep hold of all the related files. So the names of those folders only is going to be self-explanatory for you to understand the library files and your web apps, all related to the web applications and your Java files. Since it is a first file, nothing is there as of now, but you need to be aware of that on the Project Explorer, all this kind of stuff. So just click, now you are going to write a Java servlet program. So in order to write a Java servlet program, you can have the template of that servlet to be used. So if you are not very accustomed to write the Java servlet program, if you are using this is for the first time, you can use the template here. Select the Java folder and go to new, and you can see there is a servlet option for you. So creating a new servlet. So just select this creating a new servlet. And if you are going to keep all your files in a particular Java package, you can use as well as the Java package name. Under the Java package name, you can keep all your classes and your servlets and other your web files, all these things. But at present, I'm not created any package here. So by default, namespacing is not that much, very much restricted for me. So I'm using the class name. So you can use basically the Java servlet class name, the servlet class. Means the class which can take the all the servlet properties, so all the servlet methods and those variables which are needed for you to request and get the responses. So you are going to send and as well as get the responses. So I am giving a name here. Of course, naming conventions as like your class names, what do you follow it? So something like I give that my, or you can just simply say servlet one. I'm giving a very simple names here at this moment. You can use, and you can see the super class or the base class where you are referring to. So I am referring to which particular base class here? Can anybody tell me? Hello, I am referring to the HTTP servlet. It is a base class present in the package. Here we have the javax.servlet.http. So under that particular package, you are invoking another class, super class, that is a base class. This HTTP servlet is basically a base class. You can call it as a base class. At this context, it is basically a super class. Why it is to be called as a super class? Can anybody tell me why it has been termed as a super class at this point of time? Because my class, the name of the class is servlet one, is inheriting, basically inheriting all the properties and the methods which are already been defined in HTTP servlet. Okay, so that's why HTTP servlet is your super class or the base class here. Okay, click next, and of course you can see this is the URL mappings. So this is the URL. If you give this particular address at the URL, obviously whatever the context, whatever the programming logic, the business logic is going to be built up, or it is being prepared, it will be executed at this particular address or at this particular path. So click next. Fine. Now you can see what methods this your servlet can accept. So as I told you, the servlet methods, the servlet do accept the HTTP methods. Please remember. So HTTP methods are basically your get, your put, your post, your delete, all these are there. But here, if you see carefully, these methods are given as do get, do put, do post, do head, do options, do trace, do delete. So this do, when you have the prefix do, please remember it is basically to be understood as basically these are the methods, methods which are related to the servlets. But if you have simple methods like get, put, post, head, all these are referring to your basic HTTP methods. So these are HTTP servlet methods, to be very specific. So HTTP servlets, you have this do get, do post. So I'm just enabling this method so that you can have the abstraction of those do get and do post methods on our programming purpose, so that you can customize it, or otherwise you can write it your own codes. It is all up to you. Just I'm telling for a beginner purpose, a beginner who is going to start, you can take the help of these templates and these method functions, the method stubs. It will help you to customize those functionalities. So this do get and do post, only two methods I have enabled. Depending on your programming requirements and application, you can as well put the as well select the other methods of your HTTP. Okay, just click the finish. Now you can see it on the, yes, now you see there is one a template. You can call it as a template, or you can call it as an abstract of your servlet. You can see there is an annotation for the class here, slash servlet. So a web servlet is created here. And of course, if you see the imports, I've just expanded it. You will have the IO exception because you are going to handle the input and output operations as a form of a request and responses. Definitely you need to take care of the exceptions that may arise during the running state. So in addition to this IO exception, you have other packages like HTTP servlets, HTTP servlet request, and HTTP servlet response. So these methods and these classes are going to be very much useful for your program. Now, if you see here, this is my class. The class name is servlet1, which is extending. That's what it is inheriting the superclass HTTP servlet. So this HTTP servlet is present in this particular package. Please see here, the Java X, basically dot servlet dot HTTP dot HTTP servlet. So here in this particular package, you will get have this class information. So now here you have a method, the constructor itself, servlet one, just invoking the super method. So the super method is nothing but it is invoking the super class method invocation for the when the object. Of course, you can see this when the method is running here, basically. Now, in addition to this, the most important two things, the two methods, see here carefully, the two methods. One method is doGet method, and other method is doPost method. So let me just, of course, now let me just explain a little bit to you. I'll just customize this. So let us not bring all the basic things here. So you have something like response.getWriter. One method is there, the getWriter method is going to write it. So I'm writing something like println. Some basic statement which needs to be output to your browser, in the sense that a response. So you are going to the server is going to give a response. That needs to be the response, means you have the response which is given by the server. If suppose some request is made to this web page, the response is just to print something on your browser. What is going to be printed? Here I have written something like new to servlet. So here as well, you can create other object variables using your printer. You can create object variables, and the corresponding responses can be as well obtained here. So let us, okay, I will not confuse you at this moment. Just so something like you want to create, it is something like you want to write something on the paper, you need a pen. So that in this example, I have not given any pen to you at this moment. It is directly printing onto your paper from the server it is coming. But later, if you want to print your explicit, you want to display something, so you can use the printer class and create an object of type printer class and write what you want to write it on the web browser. Usually that content will be on HTML content or other which are web-based contents and web browser contents and all. So okay, now you see little bit understanding on this method. So doGet method, there are two parameters. One is your request parameter. The request parameter is also type HTTP servlet request. And we also have a response parameter, which is also of type HTTP servlet response. So these are the basic two important parameters, request and response. A request coming from the client and a response which is coming out from the server. Now, if at all there is not possible to respond to this, so here you can use the keyword throws to handle the exceptions. So the exceptions can be basically the servlet exceptions, or it can be the IO exceptions. If you are writing something with your own output objects as well as the reader, if you are going to take the inputs, so corresponding IO exceptions may raise. So that's why this is just a template which has been given here, and this has been protected. So you know what is the purpose of the keyword protected? Yes, please. Why we use this access privilege protected for this method? Here we are given an access privilege for this method, or a constructor is public. So you can see there are three types of access privileges in this program. One is public, one is private, another is protected. So what does this private keyword is going to indicate, please? Yes, please.
Like that variable will be useful only inside that particular class.
Okay.
And it cannot be changed.
Okay, the access privilege, the scope, you should tell about the scope of this variable is restricted only to that particular method or to that particular class, the private. So protected, what does this protected implies?
Derived class can use this method.
Sorry?
Inherited class can use this method, protected.
In
protected access, through protected access, class which will be derived using base class can access this method.
May I know who is giving this answer?
Vinod Kumar, sir.
Yes, please. Who?
Vinod.
See here, you are telling that this method is given, so it is having protected access. I'm asking, what is the purpose of giving that keyword there, protected? Why we write as that method as protected? Okay, this method is coming from where?
From HTTP servlet, sir.
Now you tell that I have given the hint. HTTP servlet is basically your super class, and you are inheriting those things, and which you are inheriting from that super class onto this one. And if somebody else is going to protect, or you are going to protect. Protect means, what is the meaning of protect? You tell me now. Now you tell what is going to happen there. Yes, please. Priyanka has given some answer to some question earlier, I think. Sorry, I could not see this chat window. Okay. Protection, I'm giving just, I have not given the complete answer. Protection, inheritance, protected with respect to the super class, what that mean? So inheritance, Java programming fundamentals are very much needed, please. Of course, sir. You may say that teacher has not told you. Then you will not be able to tell answers. So when do you use this keyword final? What is the meaning of final?
Sir, that value cannot be changed.
Which value? Okay, here one. That's, what is one L? One L indicates what? The answer is
long, I think.
Long. Okay, that's what your long value. Of course, this is a serial version UID with respect to the server. One identity value which has been very long value that is created, and that cannot be changed. That's what its final value. It has been, you cannot change this value here. Okay, now I'll get back to you only. Please find out. I think you are not studied the private, public, and protected properly with respect to the inheritances of the superclass with respect to subclasses. So please go through that one. Okay, now here, what this actually, this particular method doGet is trying to do is, it's trying to get some responses onto your browser here, basically. So what is doPost method is going to do? Please, anybody tell me, what is the difference between get and a post for the HTTP? Difference between,
sir, the data in get, if we use get, the data will be visible in the URL, sir.
Exactly. So in the URL you can see the data that is visible, whereas in the post method, while you are using the post method, you cannot the data has been hidden on the URL parameters or the URL variables. Okay, so post method is more little bit secure than your get method. So now, this program, I have just put one println statement onto the basic web browser here. So later in, we'll see how to read contents from the browser onto your things, as well as onto your server, and how do you output it. So along with the JSP, we will study those in the coming 2 weeks. That will be, coming week we'll do that one. After that, we'll see the jQuery and the AJAX one on the last week. So this, let us just run this one. Let me save all these files, right? And the server is at present is not running fine. And let me just click the run button with this default values. Okay, fine. Choose the existing server. It is yes. Click next. Of course, my first servlet application is by default. The application is being here. Fine. So the server is getting started. Yeah. So you can see the output here now. What is the output you are getting here, please? New to servlet. Yeah, this is actually this is running on the browser. So if people have, this is basically inbuilt browser. If you are going to confuse with this one, do not worry. I'll just take this same URL, copy this URL and run it on the actual browser instead of the internal browser. So see, can you see the output now on the externally? You can see also. Of course, the server is basically a local host server. So you can see the same thing which you can run. You need not run it on the internal browser. You can as well run it on this. So this is basically a simple execution of a servlet by using the doGet method. So later in the next class, we will customize this. We'll add the HTML file. HTML file, from that HTML file, you send the data. So it can be something like a student registration form or an employee registration form, so that the data is going to be stored in the database. And accordingly, the JSP file is going to take the inputs and show me the outputs. So the next 3 hours, basically in the next class, we'll see the JSP and the index HTML files and those things. Those are practical only, complete the 3 hours. So we'll complete the JSP in the next class. So this is the basic execution. Now I'll stop at this moment. I will not start the JSP in the MySQL and all. So we'll continue this in the next Tuesday's class. So most likely the next Tuesday class, I may join at around, instead of 2, I may join at 3 o'clock. So please, please do remember the timings, okay? Anyway, I'll just post it on the, post through email, then you'll get the idea. So any other queries, please?